celebrate 27 years as a full-time big wedding throwing tower pastor. Praise God, somebody. Come on, y'all. God is worthy to be praised. We did have an awesome time on Friday night. We ate and we fellowship and we got out of here. Thank the Lord for all that you do. But I appreciate today. Amen. He's here and I'm so excited to introduce him. Amen. To Abundant Life for our very first time. Today we do have Reverend Dr. Maurice K. Mickles. Amen. He is the senior pastor of Greater Beulah Missionary Baptist Church right here in Columbus, Georgia. Come on, somebody. Dr. Mickles began his preaching ministry, and I like what he says in his bio, at the age of 6 years old. Man, you've been preaching a long time. And he dedicated his life to reaching and teaching everyday people biblical principles that would transform their everyday life. Dr. Mickles was, listen to this, impressive. Summa cum laude graduate. Summa cum laude. That means that he graduated at the top of his class. Amen. We have an awesome name before us today. A graduate of the Doctorate of Theology program in Slidell Baptist Seminary. His commitment is to biblical scholarship that allowed Dr. Mickles to serve as a professor to the doctorate program in East Texas Theological Seminary. Dr. Mickles is a member of Phi Beta Sigma Fraternity, Incorporated. Dr. Mickles and his wife, Sherry, is that correct? Has two beautiful children, Kendall and Maurice K. Jr., better known as Deuce, who is the pride in his joy. Let us stand to our feet here at Abundant Life as we receive the preacher for the hour, Dr. Maurice.
Grace, mercy, and peace to you from God our Father and from Jesus Christ our Lord. This is the day that the Lord has made. We are glad and we are rejoicing. Anybody got a big house?
Hallelujah!
Did not prove vain, but I labored even more than all of them. First Corinthians chapter 15 has, for its theological emphasis, the doctrine of the resurrection. And Paul is saying in one truth, if you get this one, you get all of chapter 15, that if you can get a dead Jesus up from the grave,
wow,
God in like manner can get you up. And I don't know what situation has you down today. I don't know what scenario is holding you back or holding you down. But Paul writes to us this morning to say that if Jesus can get up, you can get up. And I want to encourage us today that God is so much God, that the same power that raised Jesus from the dead is already on the inside of you. And he is able to do exceeding abundantly above all that you ask, think, or imagine, according to that power in you. So as we look into this text, I don't want to belabor the context, allow me to jump directly into my focal passage. The key word, if we were to be in a Bible study, say, I tell you that the key word in verse number 10 is this word grace.
That's a good one.
You see that word in the text three different times. This is the word grace.
Yes.
It says, by the grace of God.
Uh-huh.
This is the next declaration. He says, it is his grace.
Yeah.
And then he gets to the end of the verse and he says, the grace of God.
Uh-huh.
The key to this whole verse is grace.
Yeah.
Now, grace is the word charis in the Greek, C-H-A-R-I-S, and it has a multiplicity of meanings. One of the meanings of this word grace means that God lavishly pours out his kindness upon your life.
Yeah.
Now, I need to find out if there's anybody other than me that has that testimony that God has lavishly poured out his kindness on your life. And you didn't deserve it when you couldn't earn it. Never be able to pay it back. God poured his kindness out on you. That when you look at your life, God has been good to you all of your life. That God has shown you mercy and favor. That God has opened doors for you and made ways for you and turned things around for you. God has lavished you. Here's truth that God's disposition towards you is to always do you good. That you live in a state where God's favor is always on you. Can I tell you that there's never a time in your life where God is against you? There's never a time in your life where the odds are stacked against you. If you've experienced the grace of God, God's grace is always on your side. You can be in Columbus, you can be in Atlanta, you can be in Augusta, you can be in Alvin, you can be in New York, New Orleans, you can be in Sacramento, you can be in Virginia. Wherever you go, God's favor and grace is always on you. It's where you live. Your address ought to read the favor of God. I'm trying to get you to see this morning that your lifestyle is characterized by the mercy and grace and favor of God. And because he's poured his kindness out on me, and because I live in a state of his favor, his benevolence, here's the third. And all of this is going to come up as we walk through these passages together. The third is that God will give you a special enablement.
Yes, he will.
That God will empower you to carry out his purpose in the world, that you don't have to fulfill your assignment in your own strength. He gives you the strength to do what you're called to do. He'll give you the strength to raise your kids. He'll give you the strength to work that job. He'll give you the strength to serve one church with supernatural strength, and you'll be looking at the circumstances and situation saying, I should have broken down by now, I should have given up by now, I should have thrown in the towel by now. But God, through his supernatural power, has put a rod in my back and set my face like a flint. And where everybody else has given up, I'm still here because of the grace that God has put on me. Anybody else believe that you got some grace on you? That the only reason why you ain't walked away from it is because you have a grace on you. That the only reason why you haven't lost your mind is because God has put a grace on you. Hallelujah. God has put a grace on you. Now,
thank you, God.
The key word here is grace.
Grace. You preaching to me, sir.
But the thing that I've been wrestling with, but yet this isn't even a sermon, I'm just trying to take you into my private time with God.
My Lord.
Is Paul says here that God's grace towards me. Did not prove to be in vain.
Man.
This verse 10.
Not free.
His grace toward me did not prove vain.
Mm.
Now this word vain, and this is going to be the rest of our conversation. This one word is going to cover. Uh-huh. Going to carry us all the way home.
Okay.
Greek word kinos, K-E-N-O-S, kinos. This word kinos also has a multiplicity of definitions. The first, and what I want to do, I want to put these definitions into the sentence, and we'll hear God speaking to us. The grace of God toward me did not prove vain. Kenos is the Greek word, and the first definition of this Greek word is that God's grace towards me was not without a reason.
Yes, sir.
That God, that God's grace is not given without a reason. That if you have grace on your life, God has a specific reason why he put that grace on your life. Now, if we look at this in context, we have to ask the question, well, where was Paul before grace found him?
Uh-huh.
Well, all you got to do is look at the text, and you see in verse number 9, he says, I persecuted the church.
Uh-huh.
He said, I was a persecutor of the church. That what I did before grace found me, I was one of those ones who was harassing the church. You need to correlate verses. Look at 1 Timothy chapter 1. It says there that he was a blasphemer, that he was a persecutor, and that he was a violent aggressor. And we can take those terms and say it this way. Paul was the kind of person who said what he wanted to say, did what he wanted to do, and didn't care who he hurt in the process. Ooh, I'm going to sign my amens because you don't want to be honest with me on this third Sunday in March, that you was the kind of person that said what you wanted to say. Ooh, amen to the lights. I said, you were the kind of person that did what you wanted to do and didn't care if I hurt your feelings in the process. Paul says, I was the kind of person that knew how to take my words and address you, read you, fulfill my kept receipts just so I can run for it. Paul says, and then I do what I wanted to do, because I need to come and find you and bring you down to the top of this mountain. I was coming to get you, and it didn't bother me if it hurt your feelings. Jesus, if it moved you from your place of comfort, because that's just who I was, and then I met Jesus. Amen. Yeah, I watch this would be a good place. I said, but then I met Jesus, and the way I used to be before I met Jesus, I can't be that way anymore because he changed me.
Amen.
I'm supposed to be able to cuss you out, but he changed me. We were supposed to go outside and have this like men, but he changed me.
Come on, Pastor.
And because he changed me,
I like how he says it in the text.
He says, God has changed me by his grace. He's talking about roles to masters, and he describes his encounter with Jesus as an untimely birth. When you look at it in the original, it's any abnormal birth, so it's a wide range of applications. But in this passage, he's really saying that it was a typical delivery, that it took God some work to get that stuff out of me. Anybody else other than me gonna be honest that I fought the process, that I tried to hold on to who I used to be as long as I could. I tried my best not to come all the way over here until he just snatched me up out of that and told me I didn't have any other choices. It was a hard delivery.
Come on now.
When I remember verse 10, he said, it was a hard delivery. Because I used to say what I wanted to say. I can't even punch you. But here's the truth of the matter. I am what I am today.
Come on now.
And the only reason I am what I am is because of the cross of Christ.
That's it.
I am who I am today because of God's grace. I am where I am today because of God's grace. God has poured his kindness in my life, and I'm no longer who I used to be. God decided to always love on me, always show me his favor, and I'm not where I used to be. God has decided to strengthen me and empower me and equip me, and I'm not where I used to be because of
Thank you, Jesus.
The Bible says, verse 10, yet not I. If I get through this point, I'm doing real good. We ought to be happy about the back half of this point.
Come on.
If I preach it right, we ought to all be about happy about the back end of this point.
Come on, dog.
Come
on, dog.
He says, I labor more than all of
you. Come on, dog. Come on,
I'm showing you how y'all can. Pastoring where I'm pastoring, as long as I've been pastoring, I've been preaching by grace. I've been married by grace. Taking care of these kids by grace. On that job by grace. Driving this car by grace. Paying these bills by grace. For the reason I was able to do this.
Come on,
man. It's called grace was with me. One, God's grace towards me was not without reason.
Amen.
God's grace towards me was not without resources. Here's the final one. This word kenos, K-E-N-O-S, in vain, also means without results.
My Lord.
Without results.
My Lord.
Reason he brought me from where I was and made me what I am. Mm-hmm. And resource he empowered me to do what I'm doing. Mm-hmm. And now I'm trying to figure out what's the end game.
That's good.
What's the end game?
I hear you.
Why did God call me out of my past? Why did God bring me from being the type of person that say whatever I want to say and do whatever I want to do and not care how you feel about it? Why would God go through the difficulty of changing me? Why would God empower me to keep working past the point of exhaustion? It's verse number 11. Verse number 11 says, we preach, take me out, put Paul in. So you say, Paul preach, you believe.
Oh, thank you.
Paul preach, people believe. Uh-huh. One more time. Paul preach, people believe. Uh-huh. See, the result of God's grace on your life is that now when I do what it's called me to do, something happens in you.
Come on now.
This is where you are going to have to call you a pastor. See.
You preach
it.
Here's
the word for it.
Come on.
This is the word keres. K-E-R-Y-S-S-O. Keres. And it literally means to say it loud and say it publicly.
Come on.
Say it loud.
Say it loud.
Say it publicly.
Yes. Come on.
Say it loud.
Yes.
Say it publicly. Yes. Now, I just need to ask a couple of questions.
Come on now.
Has God been good to anybody in this room?
Woo!
Well, say it loud.
Woo!
Say it publicly. Yes. Has the Lord been good to anybody? Because your neighbor needs to hear you so they can believe.
Yes.
See, if you never told what the Lord did for you, your neighbor would never have faith. Because faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. And that word is your testimony of God. So when I tell you that he is building faith in you that he'll reach down and pick you up.
Yes.
So I'm closing my Bible and I'm sitting down.
Yes.
I just want to know if anybody got something to eat or say. I'm Jesus to me. If it will walk here now, I got somebody to say. I need somebody over here that got something to say. I got to testify and tell somebody. Yeah. 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 He kept me out of the ditch. I'm talking about a God that's been good to me. Yeah. And when you open your mouth,
yes,
and tell what the Lord has done,
come on.
It's true.
Yes.
That God,
yes,
did not waste his grace.
Ooh, thank you, Lord, for your grace. Thank you, Lord, for your grace.
Yeah, it felt like it was in vain. Mm. But it wasn't in vain. There was a reason.
Yes.
He gave you some resources.
Lord.
There's a result of it. No. Must say that I'm going. This word in vain,
yes,
shows up in chapter 15 four times. This is the first time. It's going to show up twice in verse 14, where it talks about that Jesus did not give and our faith is in vain. But there's another that we need to be reminded of.
Yes.
Therefore, my beloved brothers,
come on now.
Come on. Be
steadfast. Unmovable.
And unmovable. Always abounding in the work of the Lord. For as much as we know, our labor is not
in vain. Come on,
yes.
Come on.
So be encouraged.
Amen. Woo! Hallelujah! Hallelujah! Awesome word. Woo!
Awesome.
Praise the Lord. Let's thank the Lord for this pastor, this preacher this morning. Amen. Dr. Maurice Mickles, a preacher that I've had this morning. Come on, let's celebrate him as he's gone to the restroom. Let's stand to our feet and just celebrate the word that was in his belly today. Oh, my God. Come on, oh, my God. Oh, my Lord, for a word that to be encouraged. If you know it was God's gracious thing that had to have, we're about to go and have brunch. Amen. It was God's grace all the time. Amen. I made it this far. Thank you, Lord. Amen. Put your hands toward the man of God. He's on the front row. Amen. Father, we thank you for the word that came through this vessel's belly.
Yes.
Thank you that this word is not just for me, but it's for the kingdom. It's for the body of Christ. We ask now that you restore, Pastor, right now in the name of Jesus, for everything he's poured out.
Yes.
Please, Jesus, pour it back into him.
Right now.
Lord, keep it. Cover him and his family, his wife, his children. Lord, that his servant is not in vain. We just thank you that he came through abundant life this morning to be an encourager to all of us right now. But in particular, me, I thank you. We praise you for the man of God. In Jesus' name, somebody shout amen. Come on, we have a good time in that word today. Amen. Come on, we have a word from the Lord today. Praise God, and thank you for accepting the invitation to come back, or to come by abundant life. Amen. God bless you. God keep you is our prayer. I'm just so full. I don't know which way to go. I don't know whether to run, lay down. They doing all kinds of stuff for you to bless me, and we just doing it all. But I just felt like rolling in the floor for a little while. Because you keep my hand, praise God. With that word today, so it was good that you had been with the Lord.
Amen.
On the Lord's day. Amen. They just don't think, oh, they can do what I do. They just don't come walking out of the man. You doing a nice stuff for me. But the thing is, before I get all that nice stuff coming toward me. Thank you. I just want to tell y'all about the journey. And this journey has not been easy. I made it look easy, but it ain't been easy. It's been some good days and bad days. We started this ministry, Mother Allie and myself, in 1997. We went to Jamaica Road and had a one-room building, and we didn't have but one room. And the Lord spoke to me in 1998 and told me to move to a small, unkempt warehouse. We went in there and we renovated the warehouse in 1998. Without a dime, we spent every penny we had. Then we began to do ministry right there on, what was that?
Cedar Road.
Full-blown ministry right across from Elizabeth County. Then the Lord came back and said, it's time to move. And we moved to the building next door, which is 6,001 meters below, by faith and favor. Went to the bank as a three-year-old ministry, asking for money, and they left us out of the room. Well, not us, but just me sitting there. And the church that was selling the building called me and said, we will personally put up a $20,000 CD until y'all get on your feet. Gave coats away. Y'all bought so many coats in here. And jackets. a little lady. I started children's church with the late ministers, the Reverend Johnson. You talking about the children's church, Pastor. Amen. Weddings, funerals, sleepovers, lock-ins. One day of abundant life, believe me, is fast and pray.
Amen.
Amen. I was so crazy. In the younger years, I would just walk, stand up one Sunday, say, we start a 40-day fast and prayer, starting today.
Amen.
And that was it. We were just on fire for the Lord. We sent signs, wonders, and miracles in this ministry.
Amen.
And I'm convinced that we've had soul patrol. Come on, somebody.
Yes.
We've had the soul out. What's the soul out? We built a little utility building, storage unit, and we packed it with food.
Amen.
And anybody that wanted to come by and get some food, we would feed them. Send them out the door with bags of food. Praise God, y'all. Amen. We did angel food with this chance. Come on, y'all. This is what the Lord has allowed us to do. 27 years. We fed free breakfast, y'all. Full blown breakfast. Back to school bags. This is a few things that the Lord has done. And I begin to think about what's the number 27? And listen to this. You'll start me. I'm going to start hanging with you so you can teach me some stuff. But you real smart.
Amen.
And I don't know if you need gnosis and all that drinking and Hebrew stuff and how you hook it up. I'm just learning how to do it. I'm just kidding. But anyway, we're going to start hooking up so you can tune me on some of this stuff.
Amen.
But I did look up the number 27 in the Bible, and it said there is nothing significant about the number 27. But then I went and Googled some more, and it said 27 means self-discovery and spiritual growth.
Mm. Awesome, awesome.
So I put myself in there that it ain't over. It's time for me to discover who I really am.
Amen.
In the earth, amen. And to gain some more spiritual growth. Spiritual growth means spiritual warfare. Come on, spiritual growth. But God began to tell me, I'm not going to bless you with all of this unless you understand why I gave it to you and the purpose I gave it to you. Amen. And to add to all that the Lord is doing, abundant life, don't even know it. We now own two vans with the titles in our hands.
Yeah.
the things the Lord has done. And he has done great things.
Yes, yes.
He's doing great things. Yes, amen. And so we are blessing the Lord for the great things he's doing. You're right on point. You've been with the Lord. Amen. It's the grace that keeps us doing
amen.
What we do. And so we thank the Lord. And to Abundant Life, there would be no Pastor Alley if it wasn't great members like Abundant Life membership. Come on, y'all. Amen. But God's grace still kept us where we are today. Didn't miss a beat, come on, praise. They call that church split. We ain't split. We just rock some of the dead way off so we can keep moving to the next level. God's grace. So I would like to tell y'all the good part about it. My niece came to church today. Yes, I am so excited. This is mother out, his oldest brand new daughter, Sandra Kimberly Simpson Williams. That is our oldest niece. Praise God. I love you. We thank you for coming today. God bless you. You promise I'll change it on again. In our church, hallelujah. Well, first of all, thank you for coming today. I'm sitting there so I can get some of this good stuff. Amen. On my 25th, they sent me to the Bahamas. Then on the 26th, they didn't do nothing. On the 27th, I don't know what they're about to do. Amen. But the thing about the one in life, if they don't send me, I gotta send myself. I'll be nobody talking to a girl over here. If they don't send me, I'll be in Vegas tomorrow. They'll just get a phone call. I'm in Vegas. And when I do in Vegas, don't send me.
Come on. Woo! Praise God. Jesus crazy.
For your mercy never fails.
Yes, you already know. Wow. It says, you chased me so much, I just thought you was, I've been sent to Atlanta Braves game. McCoy and the Celestians are sending me aggregates, so they won't be none of my friends, but they'll be close by. You can take me, you can go on and get out there. Thank y'all so much, and they put the price on me. It's almost a house note, but thank y'all so much. I see what y'all pay for these tickets. Oh, Lord. And I get to go May the 31st? Okay. Sounds good to me. Thank y'all so much. This has been a blessing. Mother, I will be happy that I will be in a praise camp. Thank y'all so much. If anybody wants to give me popcorn money, I can wear that Atlanta Braves outfit. Just see me at the church. I'll take that too. Thank y'all. Also, Apostle Tate and Sydney Cash, it's just been a blessing today. God bless y'all. Thank you again. Can everybody from Greater Beulah Missionary Baptist Church please stand? We want to love on y'all because we got good manners.